Hello everyone, my name is Lubomira Dimitrova from Bulgaria Development Agency, and today I'm going to speak to you about internationalization. This is a lecture part of the seventh module of Compass project, which name is Marketing and Internationalization. I hope you will enjoy it. Well, before going further into the different aspects, I'm going just to cover a bit of what we are going to present. The first thing is we are going to discuss is why going international, and we are going to cover the reasons why entrepreneurs decide to expand their business in the other countries as well. We are going to check which are the difficulties and advantages of this process, as well as we are going to elaborate on how to develop an international NGO. The reason why we have stopped exactly on this type of organization is the fact that as future sustainable converters, probably you are going to work for public benefit, which means that it's highly likely if you are going to elaborate your skills and you gain knowledge in the third sector. Before we go further, you should think about your own reasons to do your business on an international scale. Have in mind that despite the things which I'm going to present you right now, you will have your own motives to do it, and this is just one of the aspects of the whole process. So please, don't take all the words which I'm going to say as imperative, because you can find all the reasons for yourself and motives to go on the international scale. The company goes on the world market and enters international markets for a variety of reasons, and these different purposes at the time of entry must produce a different approach towards the new markets and they are heading for. The most common is sometimes called the increase of liabilities method of development of the market, in which entry into the market through independent local partner. As a business and trust grows, the transition to directly controlled subsidiarities are often accepted. This approach internationalization stems for a desire to build a business on the market on the country as quickly as possible and initial desire to minimize risks associated with the need to learn more about the country and the market with low knowledge base. Some of the common causes are, firstly, the increase in sales. If your business is a success in some of the European countries, like Hungary for example, the expansion of the world are likely to increase the total revenue. You should have in mind that the Hungarian language does not help in the international relations, as it is not that commonly used, and even if you use English, you should bear in mind that 90% of the world population does not speak English. He says customers are global, and if your company goes beyond the shores of the internal market, may have real potential growth. If your company has a unique product or technological advantage, is it not available to foreign companies? This advantage should lead to main business success abroad. For example, if you work in a software company in Germany and add French and German, you can expand your common market of almost 2,000 million people. And have in mind that even though we are located in the European Union, you can also always look for an opportunity to expand your business beyond the borders. Have in mind that going international does not necessarily mean that you can expand only in the countries which are near you. You can choose whatever country suits your market purposes the best. As for the second reason why businesses usually go international, this is to increase profits. Many export markets are not competitive in the European Union and therefore pressure the price is much less. It is common practice for the European products to be sold at higher prices in many export markets. Another reason to do your business on international scale is the short-term safety. Your business will be less prone to periodic fluctuations and downturns in the European economy and the market. On the other hand, there is the long-term safety, which in the European Union is large, mature market with fierce competition from domestic and foreign competitors. In addition, the European Union currently has excess capacity, international trade activity, and may be necessary if you want to save the world market and enjoy the potential for cost savings. There is also the increasing innovation, which is determined by expanding the consumer base at the international level. It can help to finance the development of the new products. You should have in mind that behind the reasons we are about to discuss, and which we are still discussing, have in mind that all the major global companies nowadays, such as Google, Henkel and Walmart, have started by operating on a single market. But let us go back on the different motives. There is also the increasing innovation. Expanding the consumer base at the international level can help to finance the development of new products. There is also the exclusivity factor. Many major company can have exclusive market information for foreign customers or prospects markets or market situations that are not known to the others. There is also the effect of the scale. Exporter is a great way to expand your business with products that are more broadly distributed worldwide. In many industries, for example, the internationalization can help companies achieve greater economies for scale, especially for companies from small domestic markets. In other cases, the company may try to use the unique and differentiating advantage, for example, an intellectual property, such as brand, model service, or the patent product. Emphasis could be placed on more of the same with a relatively small amount of correction of the local markets, which could affect the economies of scale. Other factors may govern the international market of investments and performance measurement solutions. These include, first of all, education. You should bear in mind that under certain circumstances, a company can hold an international market entry not only for financial reasons but to learn. For example, a consumer product division of COS, a Turkish conglomerate in Germany, is considered the leading market in the world of dishwashers, refrigerators, freezers and washing machines. From the user's perspective and the complexity of the specification of the product. However, he admits that his unknown brand will struggle to get much market share in his competitive market. Nevertheless, COS exposes the view that, in the beginning of the global company, it is sure to benefit for the participation most demanding market in the world, and that his own product design and marketing will improve and allow him to work in worldwide scale. In most sectors, participating in the lead market will be difficulty for qualifying as a world leader, even if profits are low in this market. Fashion to Italy, German cars, US software, and Japan's consumer electronics, and so on. It should be noted that if the company is to maximize learning from the masters of the market, it is likely to participate with its own subsidiary. Education, indirectly through a local distributor or partner, is apparently less effective and will contribute to the development of a smaller company as a global player. Along with the education, there is also a competitive shock. Entering the market cannot support the positive characteristics of the countries have been identified in the market assessment of the project, but in reaction to the moves of the companies. A common scenario is to enter the market as a course repeater when the company enters the market as a major competitor has done that. This is obviously due to the belief that the competitor will receive a significant advantage if it were allowed to work alone in this market. There are also the government incentives. It is common for governments to encourage companies in the country for export. This often leads to many companies entering markets otherwise they will not be solved. For example, the US government offered a lot of help when a company decides to start exporting. These were the first part in which we described the different motives of going international. Putting them aside, you should also have in mind that besides the motives, there are also the advantages and the disadvantages. Firstly, we are going to speak and discuss about the difficulties of going international. You should have in mind that first and foremost, there are the legal issues. When you conduct a trade in another country, you have to be familiar with that country's laws. You may also have to pay additional taxes and import duties in your country if you are importing products from other countries. The legal complexities of international business can be challenging. And without proper legal advice, you may be subject to fines and penalties. Make sure you have excellent international lawyers who have a firm grounding in the laws of their home countries. Second, but not as for importance, there are the language issues, as you may have already guessed. Language barriers are an obvious downside to doing business internationally. You may need to rely on translators when you are speaking to business contacts, and the intricacies of what you contract may be lost in translation. If you are outsourcing consumer services to another country, your customers may struggle to understand people whose first language is different than your own. The second obstacle in doing your business international are the cultural barriers. Different cultures have different values, and sometimes these differences can be stark. Gender, for example, could prove a problematic in countries where women are not given equal rights to men. You may find yourself wondering if you can safely send female employees to a certain country. Some cultures don't take contracts as seriously as others, and many cultures view the group as more important than the individual. This is why it's important to learn the cultural intricacies of the places you do your business. Have in mind that if your business grows, there may be too many countries in which you are either importing or exporting, so you should be very, very careful in your approach towards them. Sometimes even a simple email can be structured in a way according to the cultural differences, so you should also bear this in mind as well. Another obstacle is the supervisory oversight. Whether you're operating a factory in another country or simply building and selling property, distance reduces your oversight. It is wise to employ people who can tell you about the status of your business in other countries and who can warn you if any potential problems. Without proper oversight, you may find you're paying for a sweatshop labor or signing an unfair deal. There have been instances involving unsafe products imported from another countries, and it's vital to ensure the products for which you're paying don't put your customers in danger. Next in our list of difficulties is the political problems. Many people are strongly opposed to outsourcing, globalization, and anti-international business practices. You may lose some of your customer based if you are being trading in other countries. Moreover, if your company is involved in human rights abuses in other countries, even if you had no idea these abuses were occurring, you may be a subject to an onslaught of bad public and lost business. Well, basically, these were the main fields which can cause difficulties in your business when you're going international. However, you should have in mind that as any country brings its own specifics, usually the problems can be much more detailed or specific based on the business you are going to develop or the countries which you are planning to expand to. So if you find yourself interested in this topic, Feel free to research, read more about the potential countries in which you are willing to expand to. Along with the disadvantages, there as well advantages. As you may already guessed, if there were only disadvantages, there would be no reason to go international. However, there are still some reasons which can bring you on the upper level towards your competitors. But still, what are the advantages in going international? Well, small businesses as well as large corporations can reap the benefits of expanding operations into overseas markets. As with any new venture, the overseas expansion process does take time and requires careful planning. You also need to pay a particular attention to the cultural differences that may require you to alter your normal business procedures. Still, there are some untapped markets. You should know that your business may offer products or services that are unavailable in certain parts of the world, but are in high demand. By expanding your operations into these markets, you can establish a new base of eager customers without the immediate threat of competition. The nation's government may sweeten the pot by offering certain incentives for setting up a business operation, as you provide the boost of its economy and possibly create badly needed jobs. There are also the favorable business climate. A new country may offer more favorable economic conditions than the home country. When a recession or the implementation of restrictive government policies make turning a profit more difficult, expanding into an area that doesn't currently pose these challenges can offer a more lucrative alternatives. A new nation may offer an economic climate that is more business friendly, offering advantages such as lower taxation or fewer environmental regulations. Workers in other parts of the world are sometimes willing to work for lower wages than those in the European Union, which reduces your labor costs. However, you should bear in mind that you should not abuse these conditions, otherwise you are going back to the circle into the disadvantages of going international. Remember what we have spoken about the politics and the legislative restrictions? Well, you should bear these things in mind as well. However, as well as the new unexplored markets, there are also the business rejuvenations. In addition to expanding a thriving business, entering overseas market can help revive a struggling enterprise. Businesses operating in a saturated market or experiencing a shrinking market share can find new outlets for their products and services in another country. Those depending on certain resources that are in short supply in the home country may be able to find what is needed overseas. Well, I think that, again, depending on the market and the countries which you are willing to expand to, you can find many other positives in going international. Still, I would like to strongly encourage you not to settle only for the information which I'm going to provide you now, but to look out in the internet, having in mind the specifics on the countries which you may already have in mind in expanding. Now it is time to put a little bit more light on how to develop an international NGO. This is a rather specific condition. It is not necessarily related to competitors, services and explored markets, rather than the obstacles and the needs of the different societies throughout the world through which you want to help or bring your innovative ideas. As the NGO is a very common type of organization, when it comes to sustainability and social topics, it is important to be aware of the specifics of making it international. It has long been clear that many non-state actors have more influence on international policy making than a great many sovereign states. No one doubts that the impact of the major multinational corporations and terrorist organizations can have, for better or worse. But the role of a number of international non-governmental organizations has been more significant than is generally recognized, and what makes it the best of them tick is worth exploring. According to the current estimates, there are some 40,000 NGOs operating internationally, with the overwhelming majority focusing primarily on health, education, welfare, economies, industry, energy, the environment, human rights, social policy, and the governance and development of related issues. The more successful NGOs tend to be those that find a clear niche and stick to it. Those that can seek an influence in foreign policy outcomes can be a typecast, perhaps unkindly, as thinkers, talkers, or doers. In other words, they tend to pure think tanks, research institutions, or policy forums, like, for example, the London's Chatham House. Overwhelmingly, campaign forces, advocacy organizations, like, for example, the Freedom House, or the field-based operational organizations engaged in mediation, capacity building, and confidence building, like Search for Common Ground. Measuring international NGOs' impact on policy outcomes is more of an art than a science. The most successful, like Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International, have a high visibility among policymakers and produce analysis and arguments that, whether publicly acknowledged or not, regularly become part of the currency of debate. Their perceived ability to make a difference is usually reflected on their capacity to raise funds, whether from governments or their private sector. What does it make for an organization like this to become and to remain successful? Well, we can say that both as a government insider and NGO outsider has been mostly in the area of peace and security, but I think that the lessons are generalizable. Four criteria seems to be essential. First, the international NGO must add value, meeting a need that is not currently being met well or at all. The primarily unmet need seen by the founders of the ICG, for example, has to compensate for government's growing incapacity, for both security and budgetary reasons, to develop an accurate picture of what was happening on the ground of conflict zones. Open source reporting and commentary by the media were not doing much to fill these gaps, because resource shortages, particularly in the quality print media, have a long been dumbing down international coverage on sensitive and difficult situations. Second, the successful NGO are marked by the clarity of their mission. The most successful international NGOs tend to be those that find a clear niche and stick to it. When Amnesty International, for example, broadened its focus from traditional policies and civil rights to the whole range of economic, social, and cultural rights, it seemed for quite some time to lose direction and impact. The most insidious temptation to muddy an international NGO mission occurs when money is potentially available for some project that is not part of its core business and for which it does not have a readily available international experience. In such cases, diversion and dilution of the resources and loss of focus is the inevitable result. Third, the international NGOs require real interdependence. Any NGO in the business of giving advice must be scrupulous about being and being perceived as immune for influence by vested interests. Some organizations, like the Human Rights Watch, solved the problem by refusing to accept any government funding. The ICG doesn't do that, but it has always been absolutely insistent on saying whatever has needed to be said. In practice, governments have been remarkably tolerant of specific criticism provided it is well supported and well argued. The final criterion that a successful international NGO must meet in order to be taken seriously at least by government policymakers, is a total professionalism. If you want to meet governments on their home ground, you have to provide a product that, in terms of the depth and accuracy of its research and the style of his presentation, the best of them are accomplished and accompanied by a demand. If your management or finance, personal or governance, has to be sustained at the level of a global best practices. The best NGO develops strong reputations quickly, sustain them indefinitely and exercise real influence on policymaking. But they operate in a highly competitive environment and will be able to fast track to losing their way if they come to be seen as no longer meeting real needs, remaining sharply focused on being uncompromised in maintaining their independence and professionalism. Well, I think that basically this was it for now. I hope that you will manage to understand the basic concepts of going international, as well as its advantages and disadvantages. Have in mind that I'm going to present you the readings for our today's lecture, and I hope that you will have the time to read them all. They're in many cases related to the things which we are speaking, and they're going to give you some useful hints on how to develop your business on an international scale. There are some texts which are rather more scientific and will give you a glimpse on how does the academia proceed into these questions. Also, I'm going to present you the materials which I have used to prepare your today's lecture. Feel free to explore them, see them once again, read them, and find the ones which are mostly of interest to you, so you can expand your further ideas and remarks. Have in mind that in case you have any question regarding the lecture, you can email me for more information. Well, that was it for today. I hope that the lecture was interesting for you, and I hope to see you next time. Bye-bye!